Come on in.
Good morning.
On this Sunday morning.
Happy
Warm
Sunday
up, gather up around the fire, enjoy some coffee.
Did you guys see the super moon is about to happen?
No.
Were you guys out there? Did you see it? It's gigantic. It's going to be tomorrow. It'll be the closest the moon has been since 1948 to Earth.
Really?
Yeah.
I feel like there's been a lot of those recently.
Blue moon. There have been, but this is going to be the closest. And it's going to be, so 6:40 in the morning, tomorrow morning, go out and check it out. We'll check with Rick on that a little bit later.
Oh, I love it. It'll be beautiful.
It's going to be beautiful.
Yeah, we will. We've been up dancing this morning. It's only 6 here, but it feels like it could be 10 p.m. So I hope you're up with us this morning. We've got a big show ahead. Starting, though, with this, President-elect Donald Trump's cabinet starting to take shape, and his pick for White House chief of staff could come at any moment.
That's right. Garrett Tenney is live in Washington, D.C., with who may be on the short list. Good morning, Garrett.
Hey, good morning, y'all. There are 4,000 jobs to be filled in this next administration, and President-elect Trump's chief of staff is likely the most important role. One name we keep hearing about for that position is RNC chairman Reince Priebus. And yesterday at Trump Tower, Trump advisor Kellyanne Conway confirmed Priebus is a strong possibility.
I think Chairman Priebus has expressed an interest in the position. There are several people being considered, and it's Mr. Trump's decision ultimately.
She went on to say that that decision was imminent in when it was going to be announced. We're told Conway, though, who helped navigate the Trump campaign to victory, is also being considered for several top positions, including communications director and White House press secretary.
I think she'll be probably wherever she wants to be. I think the president-elect very much respects her counsel and her opinion, not just as a campaign spokesperson, but I think as a sounding board and someone who has a lot of ideas on how to implement this vision.
Other Trump allies that are in the running for top slots include former campaign chairman Steve Bannon, who's also being considered for chief of staff. Former New York Mayor Rudy Giuliani is said to be on the shortlist for several positions as well, including attorney general, and both Senator Jeff Sessions and former campaign manager Corey Lewandowski are also on Mr. Trump's shortlist for several positions. Now, no shortage of jobs to fill or candidates willing to step in, but the clock is quickly counting down, just over 2 months now until inauguration.
Hmm. Wow. Garrett Tenney, live for us this morning. Garrett, thank you.
Yeah,
Everyone's speculating this morning.
Well, we've been hearing from a lot of our viewers this morning, too. People have been writing in over the past few days. You know, Donald Trump had said he wanted to drain the swamp. You know, Washington, D.C. built on a swamp. He wants to get rid of those Washington insiders, those people that have been part of the establishment for so long. So the Reince Priebus argument, a lot of our viewers saying, no, we want an outsider.
The question is, how do you drain the swamp? Is it someone who knows where the drain is? So they can get down there, you know, they've been in Washington, been in the muck, or does it have to be someone from the outside that doesn't care about any of those networks?
Most importantly, though, you need someone in this position, because we're talking about the chief of staff here, arguably the most important role of the entire cabinet, because they have the most access to the president. When you're dealing with someone like Mr. Trump, you need someone that he listens to, someone that knows him well. And Kellyanne Conway has also been a name that has been tossed around, but she came on board, and you remember when people weren't sure where the campaign was going, and she really got in there, and she stayed stable through the ups and the downs, and she stayed positive, and she's still by his side to this day.
The last time that we had a president who was an outsider was Jimmy Carter. Mm. And when he came in from Georgia, he wanted all these people that weren't of Washington. We know where that got
him. It ended
up being a disaster.
Well.
So you need some of these people that I think can walk the fence a little bit.
Indeed.
So,
keep sending us your thoughts, your comments. Who do you think it should be? We'll keep talking about it all morning for sure.
Now, meanwhile, overnight, some more protests, guys, because this more cities nationwide, more protests, more things being looted, smashed, grabbed. And now it seems like we have some idea of how all of these protests are sort of coming together. Because the argument, even Donald Trump had said this in the days after the election, that these are not spontaneous protests. These are organized.
No.
They had a lot of these rallies planned anyway for a Hillary Clinton victory. And where are they coming from? Well, now we have some answers.
Yeah, we do. These are riots across the country, protests across the country, some peaceful. In fact, I was having lunch or having dinner right across from my hotel just last night, and by goes the crowd. Hey, hey, ho, ho, Donald Trump's got to go. Peaceful marching. That probably was some footage of it. But in some towns, it is literally riots. You've got riot gear. You've got battles with police. Look at those images right there. Tear gas, objects being thrown, cars being burned. This is lawlessness, and it needs to be addressed. And it's not spontaneous. I mean, we know the organization's funding this. One of the groups is ANSWER, International ANSWER, which is a left, it's not even a left-wing group. It's an anarchist group started by the Marxist-Leninist Workers Party. They're communists. They're anti-Semitics. They're the ones that look at America. It's an anti-American group. So a lot of these things are being funded by international and leftist efforts that just hate Donald Trump.
Some of these names you might
like Michael Morris. We saw him going into the Trump Tower yesterday saying he wanted to cause some trouble. You can see here Rev Al Sharpton, George Soros. I mean, these are just some, you know, we haven't confirmed that they are actually behind paying for these, but there's some talk of that.
There is some confirmation. You go online, there's posts on Craigslist and others that are trying to hire activists in different towns to continue to agitate, and they know how to hide the money.
We also know what's
they're very
happen.
Good at that.
They've also been getting out the message about Inauguration Day, but they're going to be protesting Inauguration Day in January, this group, Answer, and others. So
yeah, what I'm trying to figure out, though, is what they want to get out of all of this, right? What is the answer? Because whether you like it or not, Mr. Right. Trump is going to be our next president.
Gonna,
I mean, that's the reality of it.
These guys are, you know what? I'm going to abdicate. I'm not just not going to do it. He won overwhelmingly. By the way, Michigan overnight went for Donald Trump.
Right.
He won Michigan. That was the big
one. And he's now up to 306 electoral college votes. Which so we all looked at the maps, remember, leading into this election. And I remember Washington Post had one that has said four scenarios where he could win. It's not likely, but here's where he could win. No one had a map that added up to 306.
Sure. Oh,
no one saw that coming.
We overperformed completely. I think the goal of these protesters is to try to make Trump illegitimate from the beginning. They know they're not going to get him out of office. They just want to keep protesting, keep the contention up, keep the division there, because division benefits them. Unity benefits Trump and our country. Their agenda is not moving the country forward. It's staying in the muck, and that's what they're trying to do.
And meanwhile, President-elect Donald Trump calling for unity yesterday, and this is something we were talking about on the couch yesterday, something that Trump needs to come out and do. So he did call for unity yesterday, and the president, and then President Obama went and played a little golf yesterday.
Wait,
the election.
I mean, that's
there. He is.
Nice. Was that him? I don't know that is photo.
They say he is monitoring the situation very closely. But Pete, you gave a good suggestion yesterday where it would be really powerful to have President Obama and President-elect Donald Trump stand together to send a message to these protests and say this is a time where we've got to come together. We've got to calm down. We've got to support this next movement of our country, which is going to be a President Donald Trump.
Yeah, and so much contention, but it's frustrating because there's so many moments, whether it's attacks, terrorist attacks, or others, where you want the president to be leading, and instead he's playing golf. And this is another example where just one gesture, I think, could go a long way.
This could also be part of the reason why many people got out to vote for someone like Mr. Trump, because we've seen from big incidents that have happened over this past year, whether people agreed it was the right thing or not, he would get out there in front of it, whether it was a terrorist attack or anything. He would say, this is wrong, this is what I think that it is, and maybe this is what people are wanting, this leadership, someone getting out there and being bold and calling it for what it is.
And meanwhile, this morning, you know, all these autopsies continue. How are the pollsters get it all wrong? How did Hillary Clinton lose? How did Donald Trump win Michigan? Well, now we're getting some insight into what the Hillary Clinton camp thinks led to her demise, and she thinks it comes down to that letter that James Comey of the FBI sent in the few days before the election, thinks that this blunted her momentum, that stopped the momentum that they were seeing and may have led to her defeat. I think there's some truth to that. Even Judge Jeanine Pirro on our air thought that was wrong for the FBI to come out and do that. And there was some momentum that she was building, and you saw that in some of the polls. But the polls were wrong. So I don't know. Their internal polling was also wildly off, the Hillary Clinton campaign's polling. So if they're saying that their momentum was blunted and yet their polls were way off, they didn't see Donald Trump winning states like Pennsylvania, Michigan.
How about ran a bad campaign with a flawed candidate? I mean, once again, you have a public position and a private position. Publicly, she came out and said, hey, you know, we did our best. We lost. Donald Trump ran a great campaign. Privately, this was on a conference call to her donors. Rather than take ownership, she says, oh, it was James Comey and his letter. How about your private server? You know, I mean, there's just no introspection.
There's a lot of
this is what was being said behind the scenes, as you said, on a conference call, and very different from the message we heard her give when she conceded and gave that speech, saying we need to come together. But, you know, we've been out on the road a lot talking to voters, and I will say I do think there was something to, we called it the Comey effect.
Yeah.
But for the most part, talking to voters, that didn't come up as much. It was really the direction they wanted this country to go. It was they could not survive anymore on Obamacare. The economy was not where they wanted it to be. And I think it ultimately, for a lot of people, came down to what would make their lives better and who was the right person to lead this country moving forward.
You saw that white working class vote shift in Trump's direction, and I don't know that it all came down to a Comey letter. Let us know your thoughts. Yeah. Friends at FoxNews.com this morning, FF Weekend on
Twitter. It's always easy to point fingers once you lose, right?
Right.
All right, we do have some other headlines to get to this morning, starting with an election alert. We were just talking about all of the votes now in for the state of Michigan, and President-elect Donald Trump is on top. Mr. Trump leading the state now with 47.6% of the vote. Hillary Clinton right behind him with 47.3%. Once officially called, the state would propel President-elect Trump past 300 electoral votes. He is now at 306. and major backup headed to the United States southern border to stomp out of surge of a surge of illegals. 150 extra patrol, border patrol and custom agents will be temporarily reassigned to the Rio Grande Valley from nearby cities after an uncontrollable amount of refugees are seeking refuge. They have been caught, and the move comes as fears swell over President-elect Donald Trump's campaign promise to strengthen the border.
Welcome back. Well, protests are continuing across the country in response to Tuesday's election.
Yeah, but now we are learning that left-wing charity organization, the Progress Unity Fund, is providing the funding for many of these protests. Here for more, editor-in-chief of The Politistic, Jennifer Berg. Jennifer, good morning. Good to see you.
Good to see you as well. Thanks for having me today.
Yeah, thanks for getting up so early for us. So we've seen thousands across the country in different cities rioting, protesting. Talk to us about who is behind these protests and ultimately what are they wanting to get out of all of this?
You know, it's very interesting to me that the main group behind this is, as you said, Progress Unity Fund. What is unifying about tearing apart American cities because you don't like the results of a presidential election? And they're funding a group called Answer, which is you know, like a stop war and racism organization. And you look at scenes from Portland, Oregon, and it looks like a war going on in the streets. So the names of their groups and their messaging just really doesn't coincide with what they're actually doing.
Well, Jennifer,
and I believe their end result, they just want chaos.
Yeah, no, that's a great point. I think they do. Answer is an organization I learned about in 2007 when I was running an Iraq war group. They did a lot of Iraq war protesting. But it's not just that. Tell our audience a little bit more about Answer. What do they want? Who are they really? And what are these protests, what are they trying to accomplish?
You know, a few nights ago, we were looking on Twitter. His account is deactivated now, was suspended by Twitter. But Scott Fulvill, who is the Democrat operative who was exposed by James O'Keefe and Project Veritas as working to create chaos at Republican events, said, if you're going to have signs, don't have them all look exactly the same like you did in Ferguson and Baltimore. So these people take an event and they use it to create chaos, anarchy, mayhem throughout America. And I think their end result is this fundamental transformation of America to devolve into this chaotic state so that the likes of their groups can take control. Yeah. They don't want to recognize Donald Trump as the president. And frankly, I think that Obama refusing to take the traditional picture with him actually is helping to fuel this.
Well, we've been showing some of the footage. Some of it is so vulgar that we've had to just blur it out. And we've seen there's been violence. I mean, it's gotten pretty ugly out there. Even here in New York City, we see it, as you said last night, just outside your window eating dinner. How many of our resources and money, I mean, people have all the right to say what they want to say and to have free speech, but when it gets so ugly, how much of our own money and resources are going towards this?
You know, Progress Unity Fund, it's a charitable organization, 501(c), just like the Red Cross, and so they're getting tax breaks for this chaos and mayhem and anarchy and destruction.
Sure.
And then in the end, these cities are going to be on the hook, and these businesses and the insurance companies that insure them are going to have to rebuild, recover, only to what? Have it happen again? This
yeah.
is the, what, fourth night?
Yeah, no, you're right.
It's
maybe all
disturbing.
The way to Inauguration Day.
Yeah, they say they're going to protest Inauguration Day. Jennifer, thank you very much. You know, the Progress Unity Fund funds Answer, which is run by communists and international leftists who hate America and Israel. It's a lot deeper than just Donald Trump, unfortunately. Jennifer, thank you very much.
Jennifer, thank you.
All right, well, we all know Donald Trump loves him some Twitter. Almost as much as he loves, you know that, a taco bowl. So how will the infamous account that brought us this photo, once he takes off, what's he going to do with it?
Yeah, I want to know about that. And if Hillary Clinton ends up getting charged with a crime, should President Obama pardon her? This is an idea being floated around by many on the left, and we are going to debate that next. Stick around. 24 minutes after the hour, and some quick headlines for you now. The last wave of refugees during the Obama administration are coming from Australia, and the move is meant to alleviate pressure on Australian leaders who have been accused of forcing refugees to live in inhumane conditions. And John Kerry is in the fight until the bitter end for climate change, the Secretary of State saying he will continue his efforts on global warming until the day President Obama leaves office in January. And this after he wrapped up a two-day visit in Antarctica to bring attention to sea levels. Clayton, over to you.
Thanks, Abby. We're having a good discussion already because we all remember this heated exchange between Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton during the second presidential debate. Watch. Well, the New York Times has been slammed all through the campaign for really being in the tank for Hillary Clinton.
Yeah. Now what are they going
to
do?
Well, Donald Trump had slammed them. You know, he threatened at one point to take away their press credentials because he thought that they were being villainous towards him.
Well, the so-called paper of record, which likes to think that it's independent journalism, instead, they did slam him through the entire campaign and defended Hillary Clinton reflexively.
Well, and they don't like to apologize, something that we know about the New York Times, but they have come out to issue sort of apology statement, promising to rededicate their paper to fair reporting after Trump's historic win.
Yes. Here's a part of what they had to say in the letter. They said, as we reflect on this week's momentous result and the months of reporting that preceded it, we aim to rededicate ourselves to the fundamental mission of Times journalism. That is to report America and the world honestly, to understand and reflect on all perspectives and life experiences in the stories that we bring to you. I would just note that as it goes on to say, we believe we reported on both candidates fairly during the presidential
campaign. But you notice the word rededicate, though, right? That, I think that's a big one out of that statement, because obviously they're admitting they've got to switch gears here a little bit.
Well, this all came out of a Times editorial piece slamming their own paper, basically saying, hey, New York Times, you need to come down out of your skyscraper and see what the rest of America saw during this campaign. Get out of your New York City skyscraper and go and see what the rest of America sees.
Yeah.
And that this now apology is, of course, the head of the paper, Arthur Sulzberger, writing back saying, well, we thought we were honest, but we need to rededicate
ourselves. I think they're realizing what a lot of media outlets are right now, is there has been a real disconnect between, as you point out, what the American people were wanting this time around and what the media was wanting, or what they were thinking was going on in this country, which they were clearly did not understand that.
The clear agenda that they couldn't get past. A perfect example was the cover of the New York Times. If you didn't see this, you may have. Cover the New York Times on Wednesday morning after the election. This is literally the headline. Democrats, students, and foreign allies face the reality of a Trump presidency. Both Obama wins, even Bush's win. It says Obama wins, Bush wins, presidency. No, here, students, Democrats, foreign allies face the reality. I mean, it can't get more biased than
and
that.
You had other papers, like the Washington Post, even having Trump victory stuff on the front. So, yeah, the New York Times, we'll see if they switch on
what
this.
What do you guys think about all this? We want to hear from our audience, because I'm sure there's some thoughts as well out there. So make sure you email us and let us know what you think about the story.
And it's hit their bottom line, too. They're losing a lot of money.
Well, that's what it ultimately comes down to, is money, right?
Of course.
That's a big one for them.
Friends at FoxNews.com, FF Weekend is our Facebook page.
All right, we do have some other headlines to get to. We start with a Fox News alert. The U.S. Embassy in Afghanistan shut down after recent deadly attacks against Americans. The embassy says it's just a temporary precaution. Four Americans, including two soldiers and two contractors, were killed when a Taliban soldier was able to get on Bagram airfield and detonate an explosive vest. More than a dozen other servicemen were injured. And shoppers running for their lives after gunshots ring out in a mall packed with people.
Holy what the f***, yo?
Searching for the gunman who fired off multiple rounds in the upstate New York mall. Shoppers bolting for the exits. Others getting locked down inside stores for hours while police looked for the suspect. Luckily, no one was hurt there. And President-elect Donald Trump crediting social media as one reason why he beat Hillary Clinton, particularly his Twitter feed. But now he tells CBS's 60 Minutes he intends to treat it more presidentially. Listen. And the mom who bumped into Hillary Clinton while hiking says the photo is not fake. And this after critics accused Margot Gerster of staging the photo after a picture on her Facebook surfaced showing the two meeting years ago at a fundraiser held by the Gerster's mother. Gerster insisting that the post-election pic was no setup, saying, quote, it was very random. In 100,000 years, I would have never expected running into Hillary Clinton in the woods. This despite the fact that both women live in Chappaqua. That's your headlines this morning.
All right, let's get it out to our own Rick Reichmeet this morning is caught between the moon, the super moon, and New York City.
Super Rick and super moon.
That is so true. About to be super moon. Kind of tonight and tomorrow night, guys, the moon is about 30,000 miles closer to the Earth, so it's going to look incredibly big, the biggest in about over 60 years. So get ready for a really spectacular sky, especially right around sunset as the sun is coming up. Get outside to an open field. There you go. All my time is taken up. Take a look at the weather map, show you what's going on. It's going to be a chilly morning, or it is a chilly morning. It will be another one tonight. You see that kind of across the central Ohio Valley and the central Appalachians, and that's where the chilly air is. 26 in Raleigh right now. A cool day across the northeast, but tons of sunshine, and in fact, a little bit better than it was yesterday. Down across the southeast, you see that little bit of rain across the Carolinas into Georgia. That's great news. We have those fires continuing, and we have the drought that is really extreme across the southeast this week. We really dry out again, and temperatures remain well above average, so any showers today is good. Next chance of rain, probably about next Friday. And towards the northern plains, temps around 20 to 30 degrees above average from where you typically should see this time of year, and tons of sunshine. And finally, out across the west, pretty nice conditions. Late today, we'll see the rain moving in across the Pacific Northwest, and that begins the next series of storms. It's going to bring a lot of rain and mountain snow. All right, guys, back to you inside.
It's officially winter.
Thank you, man.
Thank you.
Thanks, Rick. You bet. All right, coming up on the show, he was fired by NBC after that Trump tape leaked. Now that Billy Bush might have a new gig.
Really?
Oh, people wondering if he might be communications director. We'll see. Unconventional. Plus, President-elect Trump says he will repeal and replace Obamacare without leaving millions uninsured. And welcome back. Some quick headlines for you. Former entertainment reporter Billy Bush fired from the Today Show after NBC leaked a damaging tape on Donald Trump. Well, he may be in line for a new job at the conservative news website Breitbart.com. An insider saying it wants to expand its coverage of celebrity news, and Billy Bush would be a perfect fit. And former President George W. Bush spending the last several months painting portraits of 98 wounded warriors he says were hurt carrying out his orders. The oil paintings will be featured in the 43rd president's new book called Portraits of Courage. It's going to hit store shelves February of next year. Abby?
Oh, I love that story. Thank you, Clayton. All right, President-elect Donald Trump laying out his plan for repealing Obamacare in an interview that will air tonight on 60 Minutes. Take a listen. So will the next president be able to keep this promise? Joining us now to weigh in, president of the American Health Policy Institute, Tevi Troy. Good morning, Tevi. Thanks for being here.
Thanks for having me, Abby.
So that's the big question now. He has doubled down on repealing Obamacare. There are a lot of folks out there that are concerned that they will not have health care, at least for this period of time where you're switching plans or trying to figure out what to do with health care if you, in fact, repeal that law. How does he stick to his promise and make sure that Americans still have health care?
Well, obviously, if President-elect Trump does repeal and replace at the same time, then you don't have that period. But the issue is, how does the replacement cover the same number of people as the Affordable Care Act? And what I would say is that you shouldn't be looking to add more subsidies to a flawed system, but you should do, as President-elect Trump was saying, try and fix the system, to have the courage to improve the system so we're not just throwing more subsidies after a problematic system. Obamacare increased costs and subsidized some. We should be trying to lower costs for everybody.
Right. So Mr. Trump met with President Obama in the White House this past week, and here's what he told the Wall Street Journal about that meeting. He said, I told President Obama I will look at his suggestions, and out of respect, I will do that. Either Obamacare will be amended or repealed and replaced. What do you think happened in that conversation? And as a result, how do you think Mr. Trump is rethinking things as he's wanting to repeal that law?
Well, I don't know that he's rethinking as a result of that conversation per se, but you, as Mayor Cuomo famously said, you govern in poetry and you campaign,
right.
in poetry and you govern in prose.
That's so,
you've
got to
work out the details, right? That is what the transition team is working on now. What are the details of how you do it? How do you work with the Congress? The Congress, to their credit, worked for years to show how you could potentially repeal Obamacare. They got derided by it by the media and by the Democrats, but now we see they actually had a strategy, and now we've seen that there is a mechanism for repealing Obamacare and how to get it to the president's desk. That's what the Senate and House did in the last Congress.
Well, here's how President-elect Trump, here's how he's talked about his health care idea so far. He talks about allowing a sale across state lines, health savings accounts, and require price transparency. Those are just some of the few things. I'm sure he's going to tweak more of those out as we go, but talk to us about those ideas that we do know about.
Yeah, so as I said, what you want to do is try and reduce the costs overall and look at what's working in the system. Over 170 million people get their health care through the employer-based system. Obamacare increased costs on that. We should do things that do not disrupt employer-based system and actually try and reduce costs there. HSAs also help give people more skin in the game and get people more involved in their health care and also allow them to save long-term for health care. So these ideas are aimed at trying to reduce the cost of health care so that everybody can participate, and that the Democrats want to subsidize a lot of people. The Republicans shouldn't be looking to out-subsidize them or outbid them on subsidies, but they should be looking to reduce the cost overall.
Yeah, and that's what it's all about and why so many people are frustrated with Obamacare, because the premiums, the costs have been so high, especially small businesses. So we will see how all this plays out. Tevye Troy, thanks for being with us so early.
Thank you. Good to see you, sir.
All right, well, coming up, she is a Muslim woman, a liberal, and an immigrant, and she voted for Donald Trump. That woman is joining us live to explain why. And who will take over for the Democratic Party's disgraced leaders, Debbie Wasserman Schultz and Donna Brazile? Up next, we will go inside the battle to take control of the Democratic Party and its ideology. Stick around.
Well, tensions boiling over at the Democratic National Committee after President-elect Donald Trump's surprise victory over Hillary Clinton. Tempers reportedly flaring at a post-election meeting inside the DNC, with many pointing the fingers at the interim chair, Donna Brazile. Now a leadership battle is brewing at the DNC, so who's going to come out on top? Now here to weigh in is a great guest to talk about this, Lauren Chavez. She's the CEO of All In Together, a women's nonprofit, and the author of Crossing the Thinnest Line. Lauren, thank you very much for joining
us this morning. Thanks for having me.
So give us a sense. Where is the DNC going, and what is the nexus of this crisis?
Well, I think the fundamental question after the election is really who is the heart of the future of the party, and how will Democrats win back a larger share of the country. I mean, the blue wall definitely broke. I'm certainly someone who was surprised by that. I believed that we had states like Pennsylvania fairly locked up, and, you know, Ohio is always a question, but, you know, it has been sort of a shock for many who've been around for a while. And I think this question of moving more towards the progressive arm of the party, the Sanders arm of the party, which I would have said 6 months ago was unlikely, I think more and more is going to be essential if we want to win back more American states.
So in some ways, the Democratic primary was a preview of this battle. You've got the more establishment wing, Howard Dean, some others running against a candidate backed by the progressive wing. Who do the progressives like, folks like Bernie Sanders and Elizabeth Warren? Who do they like, and what are the chances of that person being picked?
Well, I do think we are going to see some strong Sanders supporters stepping forward to run for chair. I actually, in the current list that I've seen floating around, there are no women on the list, which I think is unfortunate. I'd love to see somebody like Tulsi Gabbard, who's the Democratic congresswoman from Hawaii, who had been vice chair and stepped down when she wanted to support Bernie Sanders. Mm-hmm. She's a young member of Congress, Iraq vet, has her finger on the pulse of a lot of what's happening in the country. So I'd love to see more women stepping forward.
The name being floated that we see is Keith Ellison.
Keith Ellison.
Congressman
Tom Perez also.
What do you think about him? He comes with a set of baggage as well, though.
You know, it's a really interesting possibility. There is a big push for him. There's been a petition circulating to get him to run. I certainly think it's a fascinating dimension because he's a Sanders supporter, was an early Sanders supporter, but also brings some of the minority perspective to the race. I really think the Democrats have to get a deeper understanding and pulse on, you know, white rural voters across the country who used to vote Democrat, who've been lost to the party. I don't know if he's the guy.
That's an interesting challenge. So if you're trying to reach white disenfranchised working class voters, do you go with the first Muslim American congressman who called George W. Bush Hitler and is seen as anti-Israel with many of his stances? I mean, it feels like a disconnect.
It's complicated. And I think there's two sides to this. I mean, the other question is voter turnout among minorities in this race was lower than it was in 2012.
Sure.
And if Democrats, you know, can turn out minority votes in larger numbers, that's another path to victory, which we, you know, many Democrats thought was there for this race. So, you know, there's kind of two spectrums. There's no easy answer here.
No.
I personally believe that we have to reach out more significantly to white rural voters who've been lost to the party.
White rural voters, some might say, maybe Howard Dean's another name being floated, right? Do you go backwards to go forward?
I don't think so. I mean, that's the concern, is that if anyone has learned anything in this election, it's that the future is not the past. Americans are desperate for fresh perspective and new blood to the parties, and I'm concerned that if we bring back, you know, if the Democrats bring back somebody who's been around for decades, That is just not the right message.
How about Martin O'Malley, another name being
I mean, you know, he didn't run a successful campaign himself. I'm not sure he's the right voice. You know, I don't think he has the kind of popular support around the country, but if he's a good organizer and he can rally people, maybe. I think it's time for some fresh faces at really up and down the ballot at every part of the party.
We only have a quick second, but this is the election slated to happen in March. Would you like to see it happen sooner, turn the page sooner, or is this going to draw out all the way?
You know, no. I think everyone needs some time to digest. You know, we're barely getting through the data. The votes have not even all been completely counted. I think it's going to require time, frankly, for the Republicans as well. And I think the Republicans are going to continue to ask some questions as well about the future of the party. Just even having won, we all need time to process all the complex implications of this
election.
Especially
because decisions like a trajectory of a party have huge implications
going forward.
So, Lauren Chauvet, thanks for helping us dissect that this morning. You got it. All right, President-elect Donald Trump's cabinet is beginning to take shape, speaking of the other side of the aisle, and a decision for one of his most important positions, they say, is imminent. We're live in Washington with the details.
Good morning to you. It is Sunday, November 13th, 2016. I'm Abby Huntsman, and President-elect Donald Trump's cabinet starting to take shape. And this morning, a decision on one of the most important positions is imminent. We are live in Washington with those details.
That's right. And post-election protests ramping up overnight. Tens of thousands of people marching across the country. Now we know who's funding these folks and their big plans for Inauguration Day.
And Oprah's got a message for those angry people. Chill out.
I love that.
A deep breath? How dare she this morning, the backlash that she's receiving on social media. Of course, Fox and Friends Hour 2 starts right now. That's why I love that celebrities read mean tweets segment. It's so funny because the trolls come out on the internet. Boy, do they.
All you have to say is, let's love one another. How dare you say that?
How dare you say
love? Terrible person.
Come on.
This morning it was producers read mean tweets in the newsroom. Oh, my goodness. Wait till we read those tweets against her. It's unreal.
Good morning, everyone, on this Sunday morning. Thanks for watching Fox and Friends. We have a jam-packed next 3 hours
for you. We've got a big show ahead. And President-elect Donald Trump's White House cabinet is starting to take shape. His pick for chief of staff, it could come at any moment.
Garrett Tenney is live in Washington, D.C. with who may be on the short list. Good morning, Garrett.
Is it you, Garrett?
Not that I know of, but very well could be. I'll let you know about that. Good morning to y'all. It's interesting, though, when you look at this chief of staff position, after you're deciding who you're going to marry and who your running mate will be, the chief of staff is right up there in the most important decisions that a president-elect will make. Right now, we're told there are two men being considered for the job. Not Garrett Tenney, but former campaign chairman Steve Bannon and RNC chairman Reince Priebus. One of the main roles for the chief of staff will be to serve as a bridge between the White House and Capitol Hill and other agencies to advance the president's agenda. All of that would appear to make Priebus an ideal candidate with his knowledge of D.C. and connections to GOP lawmakers. Yesterday at Trump Tower, Trump advisor Kellyanne Conway confirmed he is a strong possibility.
Chairman Priebus has expressed an interest in the position. There are several people being considered, and it's Mr. Trump's decision ultimately.
Look for Conway to play a large role in the Trump administration as well. She's received tremendous credit for turning the Trump campaign around and helping navigate it to victory.
I think she'll be probably wherever she wants to be. I think the president-elect very much respects her counsel and her opinion, not just as a campaign spokesperson, but I think as a sounding board and someone who has a lot of ideas on how to implement this vision.
A few other Trump allies who are on Mr. Trump's shortlist for his cabinet include former New York Mayor Rudy Giuliani for the role of Attorney General. Senator Jeff Sessions, who serves on the Senate Committee on Armed Forces, is being considered for Secretary of Defense. And we're told former Trump campaign manager Corey Lewandowski is being considered for several senior advisor roles as well. Over the next few weeks, there will be plenty more names thrown out there as well, but we can expect to see some of those top positions announced on the sooner side before the rest unfolds, and I will be keeping my ringer on over those next few weeks.
Your name is now on the list, Garrett.
I know.
Thanks, Garrett.
You never know.
So we asked our viewers earlier this morning what did they want to see, and Karen emailed us this morning saying, Kellyanne Conway should be the chief of staff. If not for her, I do not believe Mr. Trump would be president-elect. She was calm in a sea of storms.
Yeah. I like that. William tweeted this, the best choice, Reince Priebus, level-headed and knows Washington.
And John emailed, I think Ben Carson would be the best possible. possible person in that position. I'm glad we have a loud, strong leader to do the yelling. Now we need a great voice of reason in the background.
Keep those coming in. We want to hear from you guys.
All right. And now, you know, protests overnight. Again, a fourth night now of massive protests across the country. Yep. We saw everything unfolding in Portland and cities nationwide. And, you know, Donald Trump had criticized these protests in the wake of the election, saying, look, these aren't just spontaneous protests, people just coming out of their house angry. This is organized or receiving emails, told where to show up, and what to do when they get there.
Yeah. Some people putting up money behind it, right?
No, a lot of money behind it. And look, they are spreading. You talk about, I mean, this is where they are across the country. You don't just, they're not spontaneous. They're well-funded. We've had some segments. We'll talk even more about who's funding them. The question I have, Abby, we talked about this. Mm-hmm. What are they protesting?
Right.
Honestly, there was a protest went outside the restaurant I was at last night. You walk out, talk to some of these folks. They just want Donald Trump out. Well, we just had an election.
Where were they before the election?
Delicate snowflakes. They just want to revolt.
Can we put up that map again? Because if you look in the areas where this map took place, and you look in areas like Philadelphia, look at Minnesota just voted for Donald Trump. Overnight, we now got word.
Michigan did.
Michigan.
Minnesota was close, though.
So look at Michigan. Look at Detroit. Philadelphia, the numbers of people that turned out for Hillary Clinton were down significantly compared to where they were for President Obama a number of years ago.
Right.
So if these same people would have gotten out and voted.
That's the big question. I wanted to shout out my window yesterday. I'm like, did you even vote this time around? To your point, what do they want out of this, whether they like it or not? Mr. Trump is going to be our next president. But there have been some big names that have been behind some of the organization here. Michael Moore, for example, was seen at Trump Tower yesterday. You have George Soros, Reverend Al Sharpton. I mean, these guys have been out there really trying to rile up these protests, which obviously doesn't make the situation any better.
Of course, you're allowed to protest if you want, but you're not allowed to burn police cars and throw things at cops and block traffic and do unlawful things day after day after day. It's called law and order. But the groups that are doing this are not, they want perpetual anarchy, and a lot of these groups are based in that. One of the groups is ANSWER, International ANSWER, funded internationally. A lot of it comes from George Soros, MoveOn.org type money. This is a front group for the Marxist-Leninist Workers' Party. These are communists. These are anarchists. They're anti-Semitic. They're not pro-American, you know, conservative or liberals who are frustrated with conservatism. They're anti-American, and they want to foment chaos across our country.
And it's not going to end just now. They want, by Inauguration Day, they're already organizing for the protests that they're going to hold on.
I mean, already, and that's January 20th, so you think this is going to slow down. Seems like this is going to continue on.
So we should all just take a deep breath. Remember Oprah's comments yesterday? Oprah yesterday or the other day saying on Entertainment Tonight that she, when she saw that picture of President Obama and Donald Trump, this is what happened. Watch.
So that's such a nice message that I think you want to hear.
And no, Abby.
You would think that the response would be like, go, Oprah. You know what? Good for you. Good for standing up for coming together as a country.
Well, leadership role. She was a Trump. She was a Clinton supporter and Obama supporter. But as you said, not so nice.
Yeah, backfired. So Twitter, of course, social media where all trolls live, just jumped right on her. Heather Mataraz wrote this. Oprah, you can take a deep breath and hold it while the rest of us literally fight for our lives right now.
Hold on. This is the mindset, though. Somehow they're fighting for their lives. Okay.
Here's another one. Oprah, what the bleep? This is not one of my favorite things.
Well, Patton Oswalt, a pretty famous actor.
She does those favorite things, not one of his. There's another tweet that says, I will never forget that you did this, Oprah. Awful.
Ooh, never forget.
Awful.
And then another one from Bexa Raven tweeting this, Oprah, dead to
This might be my favorite one, though. I mean, really?
Dead to me.
I mean, really?
But don't think about the hyperbole that is, I'm fighting for my life. Okay? Donald Trump was elected, I'm fighting for my life. But guess what? There are folks in Iraq and Afghanistan right now fighting for your life.
Well, and
get
also,
some perspective.
That's a great point. And all she was saying, by the way, take a deep breath. Can't we all
take a deep
breath
right
now?
That's not even what she was saying. I'm reading over her quote again. She said, I felt like we'd reached a moment where Trump was humbled by the experience to hear Obama say that he has renewed confidence in a peaceful transition. No, you don't want a peaceful transition?
Guys,
you want chaos in this country?
We're better than this.
No,
we are better than this, aren't we?
Most are. Agitators are not because they benefit from it.
So frustrating. All right, we have some other headlines to get to this morning, starting with an election alert. The votes in Michigan have now all been tallied. President-elect Donald Trump finishing on top there. Mr. Trump leading the state with 47.6% of the vote. Hillary Clinton right behind him with 47.3%. And once officially called, the state will propel President-elect Trump to 306 electoral votes. and major backup headed to the United States southern border to stomp out a surge of illegals. 150 extra Border Patrol and custom agents will be temporarily reassigned to the Rio Grande Valley. An uncontrollable amount of people seeking refuge have been caught trying to cross that border, and the move comes as fears swell over President-elect Donald Trump's campaign promise to strengthen the border. And another cop ambush, this time in Alaska. The officer shot repeatedly while lying on the ground during a shootout. That ended with a gunman shot to death.
I have watched the video from this situation. It was a clear and intentional ambush.
Officers referring to dash cam video, they say police were responding to a theft when they spotted the suspect on the street. The cops pulling over only to be met with a barrage of bullets. The wounded officer receiving emergency surgery and luckily is expected to be okay. And listen to this one. President-elect Donald Trump's first wife celebrating his win by asking for a favor, a new job as, get this, ambassador. The former Mrs. Trump saying she would like to serve as U.S. ambassador to her home country of the Czech Republic. She also predicted her husband will vacation at Mar-a-Lago, and he won't give up his Trump Tower apartment once he's in the White House. A lot of good information coming from his ex-wife there.
There's word this morning that he may spend weekends in New York City at his high-rise apartment.
And I still don't think we're sure about whether Melania Trump will move full-time to the White House or not to raise her son.
I know. Let's get for answers on this and more. Let's get Rick Reichmuth in on this.
It sounds amazing.
Do you have the answers, Rick?
It sounds amazing for Midtown Manhattan.
Right.
Because there's not traffic, there's not issues getting around Manhattan if you've ever been here.
And add some protest to it, too.
And a president.
Exactly. All right, guys. Well, it is chilly out there this morning. We have freeze advisories in effect. And here you see these colored areas as parts of Delaware in towards Maryland, stretching all the way back in towards parts of Oklahoma. So a very chilly morning to start out. It warms up a little bit tonight, but it will be another chilly one. And this right here where you see that kind of light purple, that's where those temperatures are below freezing, 27 in Raleigh. So a really cold one. It's also been incredibly dry. We have a little bit of rain today right here across parts of Georgia and in towards South Carolina. This is great news. We desperately need the precipitation, especially in the southern Appalachians. It's not going to be a lot, but we have these fires going on right here, and this is our last chance to get any rain, at least until the end of this coming week. So we'll eke a little bit of it out. No other precipitation except in towards the Pacific Northwest. That is what's going to be coming in. And we've had a really calm pattern of weather for the last couple of weeks. That is about to change. Temperatures still remain well above average, especially across the Central Plains. We're going to be seeing some temps maybe 25 to 30 degrees above average. And we remain warm kind of all week here across the south southeast. Get ready, though. By midweek, the moisture comes to the west. And we might, guys, be talking about a bit of a blizzard in across the Northern Plains by the time we get towards the latter part of this week.
Man.
So get ready. It's coming.
I got to get the shovel out of the garage, is what you're telling
Minnesota,
me?
Minnesota, get ready.
Get
all right.
Door,
the work, they will be working soon.
Thank you,
Gunner, get ready.
While you're sitting there drinking some coffee. Get out there.
Oh,
that's why we have kids.
That's why we have them.
Mow the lawn.
Labor force.
Thanks, Rick.
For free.
Yeah, totally. Not free, though. All right. What will President-elect Trump do to fight terror? Our next guest, an Iraq War veteran, says when it comes to global threats, he's in for a rude awakening.
Plus, former Attorney General Eric Holder has a new pet project. He's back.
Four Americans, two service members, and two contractors were unfortunately killed in an explosion that rocked Bagram Air Force Base in Afghanistan this weekend. The Taliban taking responsibility for this grim reminder of the many global threats, like a nuclear-armed Iran, that President-elect Trump will inherit come January. Joining us now with his reaction, retired Army Sergeant and Purple Heart recipient Robert Bartlett. He's an Iraq War veteran and now serves on the Veterans Advisory Council at the United Against Nuclear Iran. Good morning, Robert.
Good morning, Pete. How are you doing?
So this attack, any loss of life is unfortunate in Afghanistan. We saw that over the weekend. What does Donald Trump, President-elect Trump, need to do in Afghanistan to turn a corner there?
I think he needs to reach out to our partners out in the region and get a unified mission against stopping these terrorists that are just pushing a continued war or terrorism or hatred towards the Muslim community. Until this stops, people are going to see the association between these terrorists and the Muslim community.
And they see the weakness of our approach there, no doubt.
Speaking
of weakness, an Iranian deal was a centerpiece of what this administration did in trying to believe that they could prevent Iran from getting a nuclear weapon. Donald Trump now coming in has said he would scrap the deal, but one of his advisors, Waleed Faris, said just recently that he may take a slightly different approach. I want to play that clip and get you to react to it.
Ripping up is maybe a too strong a word. He's going to take that agreement, and it's been done before in international context, and then review it. It could be a tense discussion, but the agreement as is right now, sending $150 billion to the Iranian regime without receiving much in return, and increasing Iranian intervention in four countries, that is not going to be accepted by a Trump administration.
So he said he wants to tear it up. A little bit of a walk back there. What should President-elect Trump do about the Iranian deal?
If that's true, that's a big walk back. That's not a little walk back. That's a big walk back. Should have torn it up and then worked towards putting more sanctions on. It's a terrorist regime. We know that. They not only kill Americans, have at least at the numbers we're looking at, about 1,000 American soldiers. That doesn't include the civilians that have been killed, tortured, or kept captive. So these are things that we need to think about, and he needs to put into his thought process on developing a new deal and putting more sanctions on Iran and putting that pressure on until we can get them to actually act like a citizen of the world and not a terrorist.
Sergeant Bartlett, I've seen you talk about this before. I know you were wounded yourself by an Iranian weapon. You understand the nature of this regime. What is, even if it's tearing up or slightly walking back, what is the first thing President-elect Trump should do to send signal to the Iranians that we mean business?
Stop the flow of billions of dollars. You know, we just lost four Americans. Who are they getting supported by? Is it the selling of drugs into this country by heroin, or is it a direct support from Iran? Where are they getting the money? Or is it coming from Saudi Arabia? No matter what, the money needs to stop, because we know that Iranians fund terrorism. That's the first place I would stop. Stop the funding there, and then move forward with a comprehensive plan using some of our allies in the region to really put pressure on and to correct the bad behavior.
Funding, such an important place to start. We just only have a couple of seconds here, Sergeant. In addition to that, have we seen Iran live by the deal so far?
No, actually, it just broke it this week with the heavy water. So not only that, with their general Soleimani traveling, I mean, just time and time again, I mean, it's not good.
Huge involvement in Iran. When you talk about terrorism, one of the first places
number
to
one
look is Iran.
Yeah, number
Sergeant
one.
Robert
yeah.
Bartlett, thank you for your service to our country and for speaking truth this morning.
Thanks for your service too, Pete.
Thank you. All right, Donald Trump wants to cut funding for sanctuary cities. And this morning, one mayor says her city will stand up to the president-elect. Plus, the election is tearing the country in half. So what can people do to heal and find, you know, some inner peace? Maybe take a deep breath. Oh, there he is. He's taking many deep breaths. That is Father John. He has some advice for us.
Back with some quick headlines. House Republicans trying to stop Boeing from selling any planes to a terrorist-friendly country. Congress will vote next week to cancel the planned sale of a $17 billion worth of commercial aircraft to Iran. It's a transaction made possible by President Obama's controversial Iran deal, and that President-elect Trump promises to scrap. And Turkey, the country that serves as a pit stop for terrorists waging jihad, is concerned about the safety of its citizens. Here in the U.S., the country warning citizens about traveling to the U.S. due to potentially violent liberal riots over this election. There's some headlines this morning.
Thank you, Abby. Well, protesters still taking to the streets at this hour.
Not our president!
Not our president!
Not our president!
Not our president! But despite the uproar over President-elect Donald Trump, the Pope tweeted out this positive message following Donald Trump's win. He said, "May we make God's merciful love ever more evident in our world through dialogue, mutual acceptance, and fraternal cooperation."
I like that. So how can people find inner peace after such a contentious election? Let's bring in now Fox News religion contributor Father Jonathan Morris. And never been a more important morning, I think, to have you here when
we
it feels
help.
Like.
We all need help.
Everything is going to be
all
okay.
Need help. What is your message this morning?
First of all, these protests are going to die down. You know, people have to get back to work. At least most of them have to
not
get back
everybody.
To work. Most of them have to get back to work. It'll die down. It'll pick up again around inauguration.
I mean, they have lives to get to.
Yes, but that's okay. Everything is going to be okay. And I've been very happy with how President Obama has handled all of this. Excellent. For somebody like me who's been rather critical of President Obama over the last 8 years, he's done a great job. Hillary Clinton has done a great job of calling and conceding. Everything is going to be okay. And then President-elect Trump, I think, has done a great job of saying he's going to be pragmatic. I love the fact that he says, I'm going to keep some things in Obamacare, Whoa! How can he say that? It's called compromise. We haven't heard compromise in 8 years. Compromise is not a bad idea.
But I like the idea of people working together to actually get things done. It'll be interesting to see. But people have lost friends over this. I mean, so Thanksgiving is coming up.
Yeah.
People, families are going to be coming together. Family members aren't talking to other family members because they were either Trump supporters or Clinton supporters, and they're just not talking. How do you, your congregation, what is that message? How do you bring people together?
My congregation is predominantly Hispanic. I also have an Italian portion of the parish, but a lot of the Hispanics are fearful. And I'm going to be speaking at all of the masses today, and I'm going to say everything is going to be okay. Everything's going to be okay. And I hope there's going to be some compromise on the whole immigration issue. If that would go so far in order to bring our country back together, seal the border, no doubt. It's not good for immigrants to be coming across the border as it is right now. It's bad for them, it's bad for the country, but it's also bad for those who are coming illegally. And then try to help those who have been here for many, many years, who have not committed any crimes, not necessarily amnesty, but some sort of path towards legal status so that they can work and go back and visit family and then come back. There's so much that can be done. And I hope that President-elect Trump is pragmatic and he seeks the common good.
What's your message to individuals today? Because the leaders have set a good tone, as you said, but individuals in their own lives who have fractured relationships in their families or with friends, what can they do to be proactive to rebuild relationships?
You know, I sat with several people during election night, all of whom basically had the same core values. One or two of them was crying. The other one was super happy.
Mm. How can we be on such different pages, right?
Well, at the same time, having a lot of the same values. And so I think we have to say, I'm going to hold back. I'm not going to be gloating, or I'm not going to be, you know, doing some of the craziest things some of the protesters have done. Those who say, he's not my president. Well, he will be your president, unless you're leaving. Okay, so that's the reality. We have to walk in the other person's shoes and say, I'm not going to gloat. Maybe there's a very personal reason why they're so sad. Why they're so angry. Maybe there's a very personal reason. It's not because those who voted Trump were all racist. Okay, that's a narrative that if you believe that, it's wrong. Why? Look at all the swing states that voted for President Obama once, twice, and now voted for Donald Trump. Are they all racist because they voted for Trump?
That's a great point.
No! So we have to walk in the other person's shoes. I'm pretty excited.
That is such a good message. And exactly,
we're on the right path.
We needed that. We needed you here this morning, Father John. Always
Thanks,
good to
Father.
Have you on the couch.
Appreciate
Thank you
it.
Very much.
All right, coming up here on the show, she's a Muslim American, a liberal, and an immigrant, and she voted for Donald Trump. That woman joins us live to explain why next.
And remember him, disgraced Attorney General Eric Holder is back with a new project. It might be unconstitutional, but who cares? Because it's going down like timber.
And Minneapolis wants to keep harboring illegal aliens no matter what President-elect Donald Trump decides to do. Mayor Betsy Hodges threatening to keep it as a sanctuary city, even though Mr. Trump has promised to deny federal funding. The mayor releasing this statement saying, in part, I will continue to stand by and fight for immigrants in Minneapolis regardless of President-elect Trump's threats.
Of course.
Listen to this. Paper or plastic? Now a question of the past in California, along with voting heavily for Hillary Clinton, the state also voting to uphold its ban on plastic carryout bags. Shoppers now must continue bringing in their own bags or pay 10 cents for plastic. And then here's this story. Third graders have some advice for President-elect Donald Trump. Students at a Washington State school making a list for some of the issues that they want Mr. Trump to work on once he's officially sworn into office. While some of the hilarious ones include studying about being a president and working on his speeches, many listed serious topics like gun control, tackling terrorism, and, of course, creating jobs. I love that.
Studying
that is so
president.
Cute.
Be nice.
Yeah. Be nice.
I love all these mayors racing to the bottom to keep their sanctuary cities. We'll see how that goes.
Yeah, we'll see. All right, let's pass it out to Rick. It is freezing outside this morning, Rick.
Yeah, Rick was asking earlier, he said, when can I start doing the weather inside? It's winter time now.
I know. I said half in, half out. How about that? But I'm still not ready to throw on a coat. I always resist as long as possible.
Until January.
Till January. It's about to happen, though. Yeah, it's a chilly morning, especially down across the south and in towards the central area of the mid-Atlantic. Take a look at the map, show you what I'm talking about. It's cold, but it's also dry. This is a drought monitor. And we've talked for years about the drought going on across California. We have not given as much attention to the drought that's been building this summer across the southeast. And you see, especially in that darker kind of red area, parts of Alabama and in towards Tennessee and Georgia, and then over towards South Carolina, incredible drought going on there. And because of that, we have all kinds of wildfires and no real relief in sight, unfortunately. I hate to say that, a lot of smoke going on. So people with respiratory issues, it's going to be a problem. Across the northeast and the mid-Atlantic today, a nicer day than yesterday. Temps are going to warm up probably about 8 to 10 degrees from where you were yesterday. And down across the southeast, you do see a little bit of showers this morning across parts of Georgia and in towards South Carolina. Not enough to help that drought, not enough to help the fires, but at least we'll get a little bit in there and we'll take it. All right, Pete, we'll send it to you inside.
You got it, Rick. Thanks a lot. You bet. Appreciate it. All right, some Muslim leaders are expressing concern over the election results.
I'm concerned about a candidate who is now going to be president who said on the campaign trail that he wants to ban all Muslims en masse just because they're Muslim. This election cycle was as much about race as anything else.
Just to note, that's the executive director of CARE, which is the arm of the Muslim Brotherhood here in the United States. But one Muslim woman is defying that notion. Her Washington Post essay saying, and I quote, "I'm a Muslim, a woman, and an immigrant. I voted for Trump." And that article has gone viral. Here with us this morning is co-founder of the Muslim Reform Movement and author of Standing Along, an American Woman's Struggle for the Soul of Islam. Asra Nomani joins us now. Asra, thank you very much for joining us this morning.
Oh, good morning. Good morning.
So what do you make of the reaction of Muslim groups, and why yourself did you step out and say, I'm a liberal, I'm a Muslim, and I'm voting for Trump?
Well, I'm also a mother, and I sat at strip side yesterday with my son here in Milwaukee at a fencing tournament, and he had some fear, he had some tension, and I sat there and I told him, sit up straight, take a deep breath, and release your fears. And I found it so interesting that Oprah told this to the country, and she is being trashed. I just sent her my love, because I do believe that we all have to stop and see the humanity in each other. I have policy problems with the Obama administration. As a Muslim, I believe that the left has sadly lost our fight against the Islamic State by refusing to talk about the Islam in Islamic State. As a single mother, I don't have health care insurance. I have not had any help on my mortgage refinancing under the 8 years that we've had under the Democratic administration. Mm-hmm. And I believe that we need serious policy change. And I'll tell you finally, the thing that I could not take anymore as a liberal was the dehumanizing of those who dare to support Trump. Ultimately, I felt that it's a betrayal of liberal values. I literally wear a heart over my chest right now, because I do believe that we have to take a deep breath, see the humanity in each other, and what is it that we're seeing out in the streets right now?
Sure.
We're seeing an extension of the protest vote that is paid and funded by the same people who wanted Hillary Clinton elected.
Sure. No, there's
and
a lot of evidence
exactly
of that. No doubt.
Yeah, well, that's what the
There's a lot of talk of this silent Trump voter, and you call yourself one of those. But you've come out now publicly, written this article saying, here's why I backed him. What's the reaction been to you?
Well, as you can tell, I don't have horns on my head, right? But nonetheless, I am now being chastised as a traitor to my own liberals, as an idiot, names that I can't even repeat on air. I've had my own fellow Muslims tell me that they hope Allah will send me to the gates of hell. But, you know, none of that matters to me, because I'm getting more responses than in my 30 years in journalism from people who are saying thank you, because they too are fed up of the polarization. And so what I hope is that my friends on the left will come to the middle, and I would gently urge my friends on the right to also come to the middle so that we can walk on the middle path.
Sure. No, Asra, I mean, the critics of President-elect Trump have said that he's Islamophobic. He wants to ban all Muslims from this country. What would you say to them about Trump's stance against radical Islam and Islam generally?
Well, you know, we've had this liberal honor brigade that has emerged over the last 8 years, and they want to silence anybody who has a dissenting opinion with trash talk like calling them bigots, racists, Islamophobes. This is a movement that is also supported by the governments of Qatar and Saudi Arabia. They don't want us to talk about the real issue, which is the extremism that they export to the world. And so I know that Donald Trump is not Islamophobic. He is not racist. He is not a bigot. He is indelicate. He is insensitive at times with what he says, and his proposals are tough, but they reflect a reality of concern that people have about an issue that is killing people from Orlando to Paris.
Yeah, no, absolutely, and we're at the anniversary of those Paris attacks is upon us. Yeah. What do you say, just very briefly, to those who say, but I'm literally afraid, I'm scared, we hear protesters saying, I don't know what to do. What's your message to them?
Well, I say that exactly the same thing that I said to my son there, standing ready to overcome his own fears. Take that breath, walk, and let it flow through your body, and emerge as a transcendent overcoming of fear. Fear is what we make it, and we can overcome it if we also make an intention to overcome it. And so that's what I would wish, because love can overcome fear.
Well, Asra Nomani, thank you for your message this morning. Certainly sounds similar to what we heard from Oprah. Take a deep breath and drive on. So thank you very much.
Little did you know that you'd be fans of Oprah, did you? But here we are today.
Interesting bedfellows that politics makes, no doubt. Thank you.
Yeah. Well, it's humanity. It's humanity.
That's right. That's right. Have a great day. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
All right. The president-elect shattered the blue wall, the Democratic blue wall, to win the presidential election. So what do Democrats who voted Trump, well, what do they want in return? One of those Dems joins us next. Plus, what kind of a first lady will Melania Trump be? We'll compare her to some other famous first ladies like Jackie O and well, you know, all of them. Next.
In order to win the election, President-elect Donald Trump breached a blue wall and secured crucial states like Wisconsin, Ohio, Pennsylvania, Michigan with his pro-working class message. So what do Democrats who voted for Trump want in return this morning?
And joining us now is a Democrat who voted for Donald Trump and the executive director of the Trumpocrats, Christian Rickers. Good morning, Christian. Good to see you this morning.
Good morning. Thanks for having me on.
All right. So because of folks like you, President-elect Trump surprised a lot of people winning the presidency last week. Ultimately, what do you want him to accomplish, especially in the first 100 days in office?
Well, I think it would be a great idea to start off on a positive note and do things like, loosening the tourniquet on the coal industry and putting a lot of these coal miners back to work instead of closing their companies down. I think we need to start with the trade agreements, putting people back to work, bringing our jobs back from other countries. And also, I think that Donald Trump needs to focus on an infrastructure bill, one that rebuilds our roads, airports, schools around the country. And I think everybody can agree we need to do that.
Well, he may be ahead of the game on that, Christian, because that's what Donald Trump's been talking about on the infrastructure issue. Take a listen.
We are going to fix our inner cities and rebuild our highways, bridges, tunnels, airports, schools, hospitals. We're going to rebuild our infrastructure, which will become, by the way, second to none. And we will put millions of our people to work as we rebuild it.
So that's a tall order, Christian. You think you can get it done? A lot of presidents have paid lip service to fixing our roads and bridges, but they're still crumbling.
Yeah, but I think there's a consensus now, even with the folks in Washington, that Donald, that we need to focus on these issues. Another thing I think that everybody can agree on is draining the swamp in Washington, and he's going to go ahead and pull the plug on that, I think, in his first 100 days, I'm hoping.
Christian, what message do you have for the thousands of protesters across the country, many of them Democrats, saying that Mr. Trump is not our president, some even burning the flag? I mean, we've seen some pretty terrible things happen. What is your message to them as a Democrat who switched parties to vote for Mr. Trump?
The people around this country need to get behind him. He's won the election. Do something positive, productive, instead of destructive. Give him a chance.
Christian Rickers, one of the many who voted for Trump, switched parties, certainly in those Rust Belt states as well. Christian, great to see you this morning.
Thanks, Christian.
Thanks a lot.
All right, post-election protests ramping up overnight. Now we know who's funding these people and their big plans for Inauguration Day.
Plus, what kind of First Lady will Melania Trump be? Our next guest compares her to other famous First Ladies like Jackie Kennedy. Welcome back. Well, Melania Trump is the nation's next First Lady, and the White House is a far cry from her childhood in communist Slovenia. Earlier this week, Melania met with First Lady Michelle Obama at the White House. You can see there, discuss what goes into the job of being First Lady. So what kind of First Lady can we expect Melania to be? Kate Anderson Bauer is author of First Women and the Residents, and she joins us now with her thoughts. Good morning to you. Thanks for being here, Kate.
Thanks for having me.
So let's first start with Melania's story, because this, you could argue, may be the most dramatic, most interesting story of any First Lady we've seen yet in the White House.
It really is. It's a fairy tale story on a mammoth stage. I mean, she, like you said, she was born, it was then communist Yugoslavia, and she grew up under a communist dictator, Tito. She grew up in a Soviet bloc concrete building in the third floor apartment, and she and her childhood friend used to actually talk through a can in a string that's set up between their two apartment buildings. They were so close. And, I mean, it was a fairly humble childhood. Her father was a member of the Communist Party, and she moved to New York. She embarked on this big modeling career in Europe, moved to New York, met Donald Trump through a modeling agent at the Kit Kat Club in New York. And from there, it's an incredible story. You know, they had this million-dollar wedding. She wore a $100,000 Christian Dior wedding gown. So it is a fairy tale, and I don't think we've seen anything this dramatic, even going back to someone like Jackie.
Well, there's no denying she will bring a ton of glamour and some beauty and class into the White House. She has said before that she'd like to be like a Betty Ford or a Jackie Kennedy type of First Lady. Who do you think she'll be like, having studied the history of First Ladies in the White House?
Yeah, I mean, I think she'll be more like a Mamie Eisenhower. There is definitely some Jackie in there. She's a style icon. And also, Jackie was criticized on the campaign trail in 1960 for spending too much money. She actually apologized to President Kennedy before he was elected and said, "I'm sorry for you that I'm such a dud." And of course, when she became First Lady, you know, she was a style icon that women around the country idolized. And I could see something similar with Melania, where, you know, those tweets at the beginning where she, you know, said, "I'm off to my summer residence." And this is back when he announced, back in June of 2015, they were taken down. She didn't go on Twitter very often. And I think it's because the campaign didn't want this privileged life to put some voters off. And that's like Jackie, but she's also like Mamie. You know, she talks about not nagging her husband and being a wife and mother. And in a way, that's like Michelle Obama as a mom in chief.
Right.
So there are parallels there.
And I'm sure that is a lot of what they talked about in the White House this past week, Michelle Obama and Melania Trump. Also, the big part of a First Lady's role is the issues that they care about and want to bring forward. Of course, you had Laura Bush that focused on reading, right? Michelle Obama on nutrition and young kids. And it sounds like Melania Trump is really wanting to focus on bullying, particularly cyberbullying. That's a huge issue for kids.
It is, and of course that kind of laid her open to some criticism that, you know, her husband engages on Twitter a lot too. I think that she would be wise to pick an apolitical issue, children's charities, maybe cyberbullying. She announced that that's something she's interested in, but history dictates what these women do. I mean, Laura Bush came into the White House and then 9/11 happened, and then she began this outreach to Afghan women that was very successful. I mean, she was the first lady to deliver the presidential radio address. So people forget that about Laura Bush. And I think history will really determine what issue Melania Trump takes up.
You think we'll see her out there a lot on the stump? Obviously, Michelle Obama is everywhere. We see her speaking all the time. Are we going to see that as much with Melania?
I don't think so. I mean, she only did two public speeches this last during the campaign. I think she's even more private than Michelle Obama is, so I don't anticipate that. I mean, their focus is really, her focus is transitioning Barron, who's just 10 years old, the youngest son we've had in the White House since JFK Jr. It's pretty incredible.
And family first, always. We will see a new chapter from Melania Trump. Katie, good to see you this morning. Thanks for
good
being here.
Good to see you, Abby.
All right. While Melania gets ready to become First Lady, Donald Trump is very close to filling part of his cabinet. We are live in Washington with the imminent decision. Plus, Hillary Clinton doesn't blame herself for losing the election. She says it's all James Comey's fault. More on that coming up.